On the front side of our lives, the side that involved seeing the world, where old friends and lifelong friendships were born, we met many interesting people. Though some have disappeared with time, others have resurfaced. One in particular stands out for me. His name is Ras Nielsen. A Danish expatriate, Ras managed to find employment in the aviation scene in the late 1960s, not an easy get in that era. Airline jobs were few and far between, and hard to come by. We both felt lucky to have scored an airline job with Overseas National Airways that allowed us to continue and fulfill our dreams. Like many journeys toward becoming an airline pilot, it has to begin somewhere. Ras Nielsen's story began in Denmark in the mid-1940s. To be exact, on December 19th in 1946, a Percival Proctor, registration number DX227, from the Danish Army-Navy Aviation Branches, made a precautionary landing in a field belonging to a farmer named Paul Nielsen. That would be Ras's father. The Royal Danish Air Force training aircraft, due to bad weather, became disoriented in a snowstorm, landing in a pasture on his family's farm. He was 4 years old. The military training pilot, feeling he owed a debt of gratitude for the kindness extended, agreed, at his father's request, to give the young Danish son a ride in the aircraft. It was as simple as that. A seed was planted. Ras and his long journey home. After a storied career of flying airliners around the world, Ras retired from Singapore Airlines as a Boeing 747 captain. He then took on a job as a simulator instructor on the new 787 aircraft at the Boeing Aircraft Company in Seattle. But Ras wasn't quite finished with flying just yet. Much like air shows here in the U.S., Oshkosh comes to mind, there are fly-in venues all across the European continent. Every few years, there is one large air show at the home of the Danish Fly Museum at the Stauning Airport in Denmark. Ras decided in 2007 he was going home and not on a commercial airliner. He'd had enough of that. Ras found and purchased an aircraft he would fly to Denmark. Yes, across the North Atlantic Ocean. Ras's journey. Who of sound mind and body, after a career of flying jet airliners around the world at jet age altitudes, would jump in a 50-year-old aircraft and fly it across the North Atlantic, barely above the Earth's surface. I know of a lad that did this in a handsome way and lived to tell the story. It would be a homesick Danish son and former Singapore Airlines 747 captain, just one of his many former job titles. The aircraft, a Twin Beach Model 18, manufactured in 1959, is the machine of record. From 1939 until the mid-60s, the Twin Beach Model 18 was the executive aircraft of choice, with the list of the plane's owners reading like a who's who of corporate America. November 565 Uniform Sierra, manufactured in 1959, now owned and piloted by Ras Nielsen of Seattle, is a collector's item. Never remodeled for cargo or relegated to handling freight, as many were when replaced by business jets, it retains its original executive configuration with two pilot and five passenger seats, sky-wide panoramic cabin windows, wall paneling, and the overall general plushness afforded corporate travelers of that era. This classic plane, powered by twin Pratt & Whitney Wasp Jr. engines of 450 horsepower each, has recently been retrofitted with modern avionics, including satellite telephone. With a fuel capacity of 400 gallons, it has a range of 1,400 nautical miles. Mariza Olson of Seattle and Ellen Booth of Halifax, Nova Scotia, accompanied Ras on the journey of a lifetime. Ras, Mariza, and Ellen took off from Seattle's Tacoma Narrows Airport the end of May in 2007, to participate in the Stauning Air Show in Denmark. Flying at 165 knots, cruising between 5 and 13,000 feet, the route would take them over the northern territories of Canada, Greenland, and Iceland. Departing the Seattle area, the first leg of the journey was to Saskatoon, Saskatchewan. They arrived there in the early afternoon on the 27th of May. The next day, the plan was to fly to Churchill, Manitoba. However, the weather was unfavorable, so an additional day was spent in Saskatoon. Departing Saskatoon at 11:30, the morning of the 29th, in a heavy wind-driven rain, they were soon clear of the weather and sunny skies prevailed the remainder of the way to Churchill. In approximately 5 hours flying time, the Great Hudson Bay appeared on the horizon ahead. After circling the old Hudson Bay Company fort, they landed at Churchill, population 750. The next day, they would fly to Iqaluit, Nunavut on Baffin Island's Frobisher Bay, and from there, they hoped to fly across the Davis Strait to the west coast of Greenland. Kangerlussuaq, population 508, the only international airport in the self-governing Danish territory of Greenland. It was formerly the Sondrestrom Air Base of the United States Army Air Force, which was opened early in World War II. The next leg would be strategic. They would fly to the southern tip of Greenland, a short flight, in order to allow, weather permitting, an overfly of Iceland and perhaps on to the Faroe Islands. However, weather granted them a few more days in Kangerlussuaq, while a spring storm lingered over the Danish Strait and Iceland to the east. After being stranded for 5 days on the southwest coast of Greenland, they finally departed for the southern tip of the island, positioning themselves for the flight to Iceland. They arrived there at Narsarsuaq on June 5th, day 10 of their journey. On June 6th, they flew east, passing over what remained of Greenland across the Denmark Strait, heading for Reykjavik, Iceland. The next day, the final leg to Stauning, Denmark, would take almost 7 hours, crossing the North Atlantic and overhead the Faroe and Shetland Islands via the North Sea, and finally the Stauning Air Show, which was already underway. They were a day late, but were greeted on arrival by cheering crowds and local TV station broadcasting a news clip of Brass's landing and reuniting with his sister and other friends and relatives. Over 3,000 people showed up on this glorious, sunny, near-perfect final day to look over the 254 aircraft that flew in from all over Europe. The Twin Beach was the only non-European aircraft. Admirers passed by on a nonstop basis, asking questions and snapping pictures. People showed up early in the morning to reserve their spaces for a prime viewing spot for the air show and to inspect the variety of airplanes on display. The air show lasted most of the afternoon, followed by the big rally dinner in the hangar. Many prizes were awarded in multiple categories, the last one being for the farthest distance. Rass was asked how many hours it took him to fly from Seattle to Stauning and how many liters of fuel he used for the trip. As a token for consuming 5,000 liters of fuel on the 26-hour flight, he won a certificate for 500 liters of fuel. Following the air show, Mariza and Ellen made their way home on commercial airliners, and Rass remained in Denmark for the next week, visiting with family and friends. For the return trip, Rass enlisted the help of his fellow pilot and friend, Stein, to accompany him on his return flight to Seattle. The first leg westbound, they flew back to Reykjavik, then on to Goose Bay, Labrador, and Thompson, Manitoba, and finally to the Tacoma Narrows Airport near Seattle, where the adventure began. In all, it took a total of 27 days to finish the trip of a lifetime. It was a few years after the fact I learned of Rass's big adventure to Denmark, and I decided it was worth memorializing. I decided to do a painting of his accomplishment, and this is the result. It was a gift for an old friend. In honor of Ras, I also sent a print of the artwork to the Stauning Fly Museum in Denmark to add to their permanent art collection. That's the conclusion of this episode of Art on the Fly. I hope you enjoyed it, and I hope you'll come back soon. And please don't hesitate to subscribe to my channel. Thank you.